Okay, that'll be a D, that'll be a D, and that'll be an A.
He picked I'll Fly Away, I know you all know that, so I'm going to add a little bit to it. Just follow me if you can, pick up where you can. I got a little medley. If you don't know the words, I'll try to help you with them, but it's fun. We do this at our church. We did it last time when Mom and Dad were there. It's our bluegrass gospel. We're going to start with I'll Fly Away. Stand. And you don't need the book, you can clap. You know the words.
Some glad morning when the sun is gone.
Oh,
Okay, let's go to 407 because he lives. God sent his son, they call him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon, and empty grave.
Wasn't here to line up the ushers, so with Jack and Jerry, would you do the arm assistant wing? Our Heavenly Father, we come to you, we thank you, Father, that you are our provider. Everything that we have is provided by you and is yours, Father. Father, take these gifts that I presented this morning and help us, Lord, to use them in a way that is honoring to you. In Jesus' name, amen. As I was working on a song for this morning, I had God kind of skipped over this song because I didn't know it, and I jumped across it, and then finally I decided, I listened to the music a little bit, and I decided I'm going to look up the words, and I like the message that this song had, so I hope that it will speak to your hearts also.
For
reason, he just doesn't trust the water system here. I don't know.
Thank you, Lynn.
Read through that, not during the sermon, but after the sermon. Well, how y'all doing?
Yes.
You guys sure you're ready for this? Is that why you're wearing sunglasses this morning? Is it your birthday?
Halloween was.
Really? I think a lot of stuff. No. It's good to see you guys. It's been, what, 2 weeks? Man, I've been down to Chattanooga, up to Knoxville, and everywhere in between.
Sorry about your mom.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, mom passed a couple weeks ago. Tennessee is still there. Got to see some family, and the house is still for sale. Continue to pray for that. We've been in the car for what?
Too much.
I was thinking everything was pretty good, but yeah, man, it's 5,100 miles, something like that over the last couple of weeks. So it has been a long time. And Friday and Saturday we're doing a marriage retreat in Tucson.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be either on communication, that's what I'm thinking, or submission.
Communication.
We'll probably do communication. Man, it's good to see you guys. Good to be back with you. And I am ready to go. If you guys are ready to go, get your little sheets out. And if you haven't read it, read it later. But the 12-point case for complaining is really good. Really good. I think a couple weeks ago I told you I'm just in a lot of pain. Just personal and just pain. And it's funny, I'm reading a book that I'll be teaching for a class starting in February at the seminary. And I'm using this book as one of our textbooks, and it's on enduring pain and just how that comes all the time on you. And I spend a lot of time complaining about the pain. So I've been done wrong, and people don't like me, and this needs to happen, and you guys need to know what I'm feeling. And I'm starting to really get to the point where God is saying, do you really trust me? And can you handle the trust that you need to have in me instead of having other people going, oh, we're with you, and everything's going to be okay. So I'm really growing a lot. I don't like it very much, but I'm growing a lot. And this is a great time to see this 12-point case for complaining. So put that aside for the second, and we'll read it later. Because it's a good sermon today, as opposed to the other time. Get your sermon notes out. We're going to go through Genesis. We're going to fly through, a bunch of stuff in Genesis. But talking about the life of Isaac. What do you guys know about Isaac?
Hey,
you
on?
Do I? Am I on?
No. Dallas, what's the name of that book?
Genesis. It's the first book of the Bible. I'm not on.
No.
Supposed to be.
Leadership Pain. It's a guy named Chan.
Is the battery down?
It says right here, there's a problem with the operator in the back.
Probably.
One of the neat things that he said, one of those things that I'll remember, hey, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Wow.
You know what? I see. I have words.
There you go.
Sorry. Sorry.
Is one of these on?
You're on now.
Where I'm walking.
Nope, they're all off.
You guys know I've been preaching a lot at First Baptist in Tucson. And every time that I'm there, they have two services, and every single time I'll be walking across the stage, and at some point something will hit every single time. But I think I'm okay. Let me tell you what's going on a week from tomorrow. Our state convention is meeting in Yuma in a week and a half. Actually, 2 weeks from this weekend. and we're riding our bicycles from Phoenix to Yuma. Dr. David Johnson, who's our executive director, and myself, and the Central Association guy, Bruce Ford, and also Jim Martin, the Association missionary, your former pastor, is riding his bike. Is this being recorded?
Yes.
Make sure Jim gets a copy of that. There's six or seven of us riding the bikes. Now, here's the deal. I have not been on the bike in 2 weeks. Yeah. And I was feeling around the other day. Man, I'm not feeling very good. What happens when your muscles aren't used?
Atrophy.
Yeah. Atrophy. Atrophy. And I feel smaller, I feel weaker, I'm scared to death. So starting today, I get to ride for 4 or 5 days before we go down to this thing in Tucson. When you think about Isaac, what are your thoughts? Tell me about Isaac. First thoughts.
Son
of Abraham, what else? Yeah. What else?
Trusting.
Treasure. This is going to be a difficult sermon for you guys to hear. Because I used to look at Isaac as one of the patriarchs, and he is. But when I started studying it and looking at it, I saw a lot of issues that lots of times creep up into my life with Isaac. And when you actually start to think about Isaac, what did he really do? What did he really do? So this is going to be a difficult sermon for some of you. And if you're holding up Isaac and all that, open your minds and just let me preach. And if it hits you well, it hits you well. And just like he's any other person in Scripture, God has given us this guy to study and to look at, to emulate at times and not emulate at times. And just open your minds. Does this sound good? Everyone on board? Is anyone not on board? Good. Because here's a couple facts. Are you ready? Isaac is mentioned 119 times in the Scripture. 119 times. 33 of those times he's mentioned as Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So he's mentioned with the other guys. His father and his son. Abraham is the main character in Genesis chapters 12 through 24. Isaac is the main character in chapters 25, 26, and 27. Jacob, did I say Isaac or Jacob? Oh, Isaac. Did I say Isaac? Good. Jacob is the main character in Genesis chapter 28 through 35. Joseph, remember Joseph? He's the main character in chapters 37 through 50. These are the patriarchs. These are the fathers. These are the big guys. Isaac gets 3 chapters. Even then, his weaknesses are what the Bible records. His weaknesses. Isaac's best lesson for us is that of spiritual atrophy. Spiritual atrophy. If you guys have your notes, there's 4 points today. It is neat that this afternoon, hopefully, we'll be able to call several members of the search team to find a new pastor. That's coming up right now. This is a sermon for them. So if you're in the room, listen up, because this is really good. And it's a good sermon for all of us. Because at times we can get kind of satisfied with where we are. And I really want you to clue into that as we talk about Isaac today. You guys ready for the 4 points? I'm going to give it to you right now, and then we can go through and decipher them a little bit. Number one, your greatest days are in the past. Your greatest days are in the past. I got a hmm. That's pretty good. At least it wasn't a huh. Number two, you depend on others to provide the blessing. You depend on others to provide the blessing. Number three, your discernment withers. Your discernment withers. And you become easily entangled.
Can you repeat that?
Your discernment withers and you become easily entangled. If I was going to rephrase that, I would say you lose your focus. You lose your priority. Does that make sense? And finally, man, I have eaten so good the last couple of weeks. Back home in Tennessee, whoo, mercy. The last point, you're driven by your appetites. Now, as we talk about Isaac, does any of this stuff remind you of anything? The birthright, Isaac and Esau and Jacob, remember that? Sold the birthright for his porch. Yeah, all right. Sound good? All right, let's start. Let's dig in. Go to Genesis chapter 21. Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12. And again, this is going to be a lesson today, so just hang with us. We'll be in Genesis the whole day, back and forth and so forth. But the first point is your greatest days are in the past. Your greatest days are in the past. I think I've shared with you guys one of my favorite movies is that the Texas football movie, Friday Night Lights. Remember that one? It's all about winning, actually not winning the championship in 1988, Odessa Permian. But then the next year they win it all. But how such focus is put on these 15, 16, 17, and 18-year-old athletes as high schoolers that this is the greatest day of their whole life. And then everything is downhill from that point on. The main character in that is a guy named Booby Miles, who's the running back, who's kind of prideful and all that. He gets hurt before the season really even starts. And he's now in a jail in Beaumont, Texas right now. His best days was when he was 15 or 16, 17 years old. Let's go to Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land I will show you. And I will make of you a great nation. I'll bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I'll bless those who bless you, and who dishonors you, I'll curse. And in all the families of the earth, you shall be blessed. You guys heard that before, right? What did God just promise Abraham?
Great.
A descendant, a nation. A nation. Look at flip over 8-10 chapters to chapter 21. Genesis chapter 21. The first few verses. The Lord visited Sarah, as he had said, and the Lord did to Sarah as he had promised. And Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, at the time of which God had spoken to him. Abraham called the name of his son who was born to him, whom Sarah bore him, Isaac. By the way, why does God, in this, at Moses, but through God's inspiration, why does he keep saying he had a son who Sarah bore? Why is that important? Exactly. And what did Abraham do when he was distrusting of God and that promise? He kind of shortchanged the process. Remember, he brought in his Sarah's maid, Hagar, and said, this is who I have my descendants from.
Did Sarah say?
Do what?
Did Sarah say?
Yeah. And he said, I'll do it. Verse 4. See, he was a wise man. And Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Wow, 100. See, some of you got a ways to go. And Sarah said, God has made laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh over me. And she said, who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne a son to him in his old age. As the child grew and he was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. What is Isaac's name interpreted? Laughter. Do you remember when the prophets, when the angels visited Abraham and Sarah a few years earlier, and they were talking to Abraham and said, your wife's going to have a kid. And what did Sarah do? Ah. They said, no, you're going to have one. His name means laughter. Isn't this great? 100 years old, not expected. God blesses you. Wow. They named the kid Isaac. He is the one. Even, and I won't take you there, but in chapter 22, verse 2, God talks about, actually, let's go there. Go to chapter 22, and let's read the first few verses of that. This is the prophesied one. This is, Isaac is the one who is falling in the line, not Ishmael. But go to chapter 22, verses 1 through 8. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and he said, here I am. He said, take your son, what's the next few words there? Your only son. Where's Ishmael? He's back at the house. My only son, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. So Abraham rose up early in the morning, saddled his donkey, took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. And he cut the wood for the burnt offering and rose to the, and went to the place which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you. And so Abraham took the wood and the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son. And he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went, both of them together. And Isaac said to his father, Abraham, my father, he said, here I am, my son. Behold the fire and the wood, but where's the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham said, God will provide himself a lamb for the burnt offering, my son. And they both went up together. I have preached this so many times. Abraham is a sign of the Father who loves his son. Isaac is a sign of Jesus Christ being sacrificed willingly. There's a ram that's caught in the thickets. That's a sign of Jesus Christ. It's a wonderful picture. You guys know this sermon, right? How many times have you heard it? Lots. Isaac's greatest day. Hang with me. I'm one of you. All right? You know this is going to be a big important thing I'm about to say if I'm trying to be one of you. I understand Isaac and in that process of who he is, Abraham's son and the father of the other patriarchs and so forth. But do you realize his greatest day was the day he was born? Y'all with me? He's the prophesied one. Here he is. There he is. The one. It's not Ishmael. This is the one. And on the greatest day that we see him in Scripture, the day that he is sacrificed, about to be sacrificed, on Mount Moriah, do you understand he is an unknowing participant to what's happening? Dad, where's the stuff? Oh, God will provide. Okay. And I've preached it before. He's an old man. He's what, 110 years old by now. And to lay Isaac on the altar, you know Isaac willingly went. Isaac could have fought him off, right? So I don't want to detract from that. Hang with me. But to know that on your greatest day, on the greatest sign of who you are as a person, you don't know what's going on. His greatest day was the day that he was born. What does that mean for us? Are your greatest days in the past? How many times have I asked you guys here in this church, how many of you think the greatest days of Queen Valley are ahead of us? Yes. Is that true? Or do you constantly go back to, you know, boy, 10 years ago we did this and that and the other. Or 5 years ago we did this and that and the other. Or do you continue to look forward to what God has for you next? Now, I'm not about to say you don't need to look back and say, oh, Lord, God did great things in the past. Y'all with me? But that's not your greatest moment. Your greatest moment's the next step. Where's God taking you now? That doesn't require any trust to look back to see what God's done back there. It's neat remembrances, isn't it? But the trust part, my walk with God, is the next step. Y'all with me? Your search team your next step is the greatest step you need to take. Not, let's get back to this. Let's go back to where we were. Let's go back, whatever. I knew a guy when I was a young kid, and he was this and that and the other. That's the kind of guy we need. No, you need someone to fit your church tomorrow. Y'all with me? So choose these guys carefully. Number two, you depend on others to provide the blessing. You depend on others to provide the blessing. And again, this is so difficult because I've always preached this from a different viewpoint. Go to chapter 24 and let's look at verses 1 through 4. Isaac depended on other people to provide the blessing. Now Abraham was old, well advanced in years, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. Abraham said to his servant, the oldest of his household, who had charge of all that he had, he said, put your hand under my thigh, that I may make you swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of earth, and that you will not take a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites, among whom I dwell, but will go to my country and to my kindred and take a wife for my son Isaac. The hand underneath the thigh was how you made a promise, a solemn promise. I'll die if I don't do this promise, kind of thing. Again, I preach this from a whole different perspective. Here's Abraham, and he doesn't take his son Isaac and say, this is what you need to do. He takes his servant, his most loyal and trusted servant. And he says, you go and find a wife for my son. The servant then, the next couple of verses, says, well now, what if I can't find her? Should I take Isaac back to your country? No. Isaac is not to go at all. And I never understood that. I never understood why Isaac was not prepared to leave. You guys ever think of that? How many of you had arranged marriages? Anyone? I can tell you, we were not arranged. Why did Abraham have to say, I need to step in here and take a wife for my son? By the way, that was not general practice back then. So why did that happen here? Do you know how far away this is? 450 miles. Go get a wife. Bring her back. This is your solemn oath. You're going to die doing this. Well, shouldn't I just take Isaac? No, under no circumstances. We can read through 15 through 26. Just the story is, he goes, he meets the gal, she's getting water. He says, did you come back? The funny thing, though, about what happens here is dad doesn't make the choice for Rebecca. The brother makes the choice for Rebecca. Later, she had a brother. He said, well now, what's in it for me, kind of a thing. And the father's not really mentioned much at all. I mean, later on, the fool is his name. But the brother makes the choice for Rebecca. Well, it's okay if she goes, I guess. Now, we usually have a day of festivities, several days of festivities and so forth. But Rebecca says, I'll go. And the brother blesses him. Y'all with me? Go down to verse 63. Don't you love Bibles that have chapters in the Bible that have 63 verses in them? You don't find that very often. Genesis chapter 24, verse 63 through 67. Isaac went out to meditate in the field toward evening, and he lifted up his eyes and saw, and behold, there were camels coming. And Rebekah lifted up her eyes, and when she saw Isaac, she dismounted from the camel. You depend on others for the blessing. Where was Isaac? He didn't go get his wife. The servant did. When she comes, where is Isaac? He's out in the field. Again, this is a hard sermon to preach. Because you think he's out in the field meditating. Man, that's a good thing. The one thing he's not doing is getting his wife. Y'all with me? Please say you are. Some of you are going, yeah, but I kind of see it the other way. If I were in Isaac's shoes, I would want God to bless me getting my wife. and making the steps that he has for me. Don't depend on others to provide the blessing. So many times we've talked about the church here and our next steps as a church and making an impact into the community and so forth. A new pastor in the pulpit, that's going to be a neat thing. But that's not going to motivate you to step across the street and go talk to your neighbor. That's an internal thing. Don't depend on other people to jazz you up to go do something. Do it now. Do it from inside. Does that make sense? The fellows, the gals that were put on this team, they're going to find a godly person, a godly man to lead this church. That's true. But don't put all those eggs going, well, whatever he says, he's going to motivate us to go and do stuff and all this. That's the Spirit's job. He's going to point you to places, and the Spirit's going to work in your heart. But no man should ever take that joy away from you. And for the first time, I've read this and said, why didn't Isaac go get his wine? Why didn't he just go and trust God and get a wine? Don't depend on others to provide your blessing. Does this make sense? By the way, if you do depend on others to provide your blessing, and God's not providing it. Someone else is.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
You just said he didn't go and trust God and get his wine. And then you said, don't trust somebody else to go. You just had to trust somebody else to go. Am I hearing you right?
I don't think so. Yeah, I don't think so. Abraham, he didn't trust God to go get his wife. Abraham sent a servant to go get the wife. So don't depend on others for your blessing. You trust God for your blessing. Okay? One of the things I looked at, many people come to church expecting the pastor or Bible study leader or whoever, someone to spoon feed them, even though they're capable of seeking God's will for themselves. Mm-hmm. Or will read great books. This Leadership Pain book by Chan, oh, it's great. I'm getting so much out of it because it triggers my emotions to God. Y'all with me? Not to a guy named Samuel Chan, whoever wrote the book, but it's to God. So I'm using pieces that I'm learning and going, God, how can I trust you in this? Y'all with me? You ever try to steer a parked car? What I want to see Isaac doing, what I want to see you guys do, is going to get your wife. moving forward to get your pastor, okay? That's a neat thing. I just traded the pastor for a while. How's the best way to steer a car when it's in motion? Go, trust God, and as you're going, He will direct your paths. If you're sitting in the parked car out meditating in the field trying to steer the car, it's hard to steer a parked car. Go ahead and step out and trust Him that He will lead you. Don't depend on others to provide the blessing. Number three, your discernment withers. Your discernment withers and you become easily entangled. Now let's go on to Genesis chapter 26. Do you remember one of the things that Abraham did when he went into King Abimelech's country and he had this good-looking wife? By the way, Sarah must have been an old gal at that time, and she was still a good looker, right? Do you know why? It's all those guys were saying, this Abraham, I like this gal over here. What did Abraham tell them all? This is my wife or this is my sister? My sister. Why did he do that? Scared to death. Yeah. What did Abimelech do? Oh, if it's your sister, I kind of like her. Get her and let's bring her to the palace. You guys remember this one? That night, what does God say? You're a dead man. Ooh. Then like said, whoa, you're about to sleep with a man's wife. Whoa. We even asked the guy. He said, Jesus, whoa. And Abimelech the next morning went and got Abraham and stood him up and said, what are you doing? You almost destroyed our whole nation over this. Y'all remember that? I always look at that from a leader standpoint and say, why couldn't you trust God and say, this is my wife, this is who we are. He even gave up who he was. Do you realize God told Abraham, through your wife Sarah, you're going to have this guy, Isaac, you're going to have a great nation. When he's standing in front of the king, he says, this isn't part of the prophecy. She's my sister. You ever thought of the distrust that Abraham had of God that day? It's not we're together. The two of us are going to have a great nation. It is, ooh, I'm in trouble. I need to save my skin. This is my sister, guys. She's not with me. She's my sister. You know. All right, chapter 26, verse 7. When the men of that place asked him, this is Isaac, asked him about his wife, he said, she is my sister. For he feared to say, my wife, thinking lest the men of the place should kill me because of Rebecca, because she was attractive in appearance. Do you know who the players are in this thing? Get this. This is the same king. This is still Abimelech, probably about 30, 40 years later. This is the same king that dealt with Abraham. Isaac then moves into the area, and Abimelech says, hey, what's going on? Oh, this is my sister. Isaac does the same thing that his dad did. It was dishonored. By the way, it almost cost him the same thing. Abimelech then, a few days later, he looks out the window, and he sees Isaac and Rebecca kind of touching and caressing and all that stuff. And he sends Isaac up. She's not your sister. Well, I was scared to death. Learned it from my daddy. Learned to cover my hind parts because my dad, he did the same thing. Can you imagine what Abimelech went through? You almost cost the kingdom 40 years ago. Your father did. Now you're doing the same thing. Both father and son try to pass off their wives as their sisters. Expedience was Isaac's motivation. What's the easy thing to do? What's the easy thing to do? He seemed to dwell in the land of, if it works, then let's just keep doing it. He didn't do the right thing. So oftentimes in our church, and especially when you're searching for a new pastor, for a new leader, when you have conflict with someone else, when there's issues that need to be addressed, so often we get to that point and go, I know the right thing to do is this, but it's so much easier to do this. Let's just do this. Let's do this quickly. Let's just get through it. I'm in a lot of pain. Speaking to myself now, I'm in a lot of pain. What's the quickest way out? I can see Isaac riding into town, and all the men gathered around. Who are you? Where'd you come from? Oh, you know, I'm Isaac. And looking over this young lady and saying, well, who is she? And thinking, can I trust God in this? Will God protect me? I am the heir. I am part of the patriarchs. He did promise Abraham, and then he said, as I was with Abraham, I'll be with you. Do you trust me? And he didn't. The last thing, you're driven by your appetites. You're driven by your appetites. And what a sad conclusion. Look at chapters 25, verse 27 to 28. How many of you love stew? Are you like me and you kind of, in that stew pot, you try to get the ladle and get the big pieces of meat in there? Kind of bypass the carrots and onions and stuff? Again, we won't read through it. but let me refresh you with a story. Two boys were born to Isaac. Esau and... Good job, you guys. Esau was red and hairy, a tough guy. And Isaac liked him. He really did. Jacob, the Bible says he stayed around the house. He was kind of Rebecca's boy. Jacob didn't care as much for him. How's that sound? By the way, we're going to talk about a big old bowl of stew. And when I say driven by your appetites, I don't just mean the stew. I also mean he's my favorite, he's not. That's an appetite. Y'all with me? Do you know that when the people on the search team start receiving all these resumes, some are going to start looking at some that go, I like this guy because he's from this town, or I like this guy because he's redheaded, or I like this guy because they have three kids, or whatever it is. Instead of, I like this guy because he fits our church. Just makes sense. Don't be driven by your appetites. You on the search team, don't be driven by your appetites. So, this compulsive love that he has for Esau, you know how it went down. Son, I'm ready to bless you. But before I bless you, would you run off and give me that big old meal? Boy, some game. We don't know what kind it is. But give me some game and let's cook it up and then I'll bless you. And who's listening? Rebecca. You can't trust anyone named Rebecca. And she says, my favorite son, Jacob. My favorite son, Jacob, come here. Hey, your father's about to bless. Go out and kill one of the lambs. And I'll prepare it for you and all that kind of stuff. You guys remember the story. Put on the hairiest stuff, you know, and all that smell. Like it. Even at the point of saying, you sound like Jacob, but you smell like Esau, the food was enough to turn him. By the way, he was turned when Esau said, when Isaac said, how did you get this so quickly? What did Esau say? God bless me. I went out and God gave me this in a hurry. God's good. And Isaac fell into his appetite. And he said, okay, well, it must be true. At the end, when he found out he was duped, and this is on down, if you want to read it, I'll just tell you about it. It says he started shaking compulsively. He was so upset. Because Esau came in, and he said, I brought the stuff. Who are you? Your son Esau. Then your brother has taken us. And he starts shaking uncontrollably, almost as if saying, look what they've done to me. The second thing he does is he passes the buck. He resigns himself and says, I've already given the blessing. It's his. As if he can't revoke that and bless Esau. What does that do to Esau, by the way? Nothing is heard much about Esau. His descendants become the Edomites. Nothing's heard about Esau, but do you understand that 20 years later, Esau's gone. Jacob is gone. The two of them meet. Remember this? What does Jacob do before they meet? Who is in front of him? Everybody is in front of him. The Bible says he sends all of his soldiers, his servants and so forth, out front. Then he sends his wives, and that day they had a bunch of wives. One reason they have a lot of conflict. And they start sending all these wives out. And then he comes last. What does Esau do? What has happened to Esau in 20 years? That he is so mad. And that my blessing, by the way, I'm talking to myself, I have a huge chip on my shoulder. The blessing I was supposed to have, the way it was supposed to work out, what I thought God wanted me to do, it's gone. I can be so bitter about that for years and years and years. And yet Esau was able to bear it. Isn't that neat? You guys have been great. Two or three things. How do I conquer atrophy? Staying back in the Old Testament, in Exodus chapter 16, God provides manna. Do you remember the manna? Little fluffy, cakey kind of stuff in the morning. Dew in the morning. Go out and gather a bunch. How much were you supposed to gather? Not for the day. On that first day, of course, there were some people who said, I know how to get ahead. I'll gather a whole bunch. And what happened the next day? It rotted. Not just it was bad, it stunk. And it says maggots were in that bread. So it wasn't just, you'd really tried hard, and we understand, it was you tried to do things on your own, and it stunk up the place, and now you got to clean up your whole house, because maggots are all over the place. What is he saying? Daily, get your manna. Remember, your best days are behind you? When you talk about Jesus, is it about what happened last week, or is it about what happened 20 years ago? Daily, get with him. I sure hope that when you guys call the pastor search team, one of the questions you ask each member is, tell us about your daily walk. What'd you learn this last week? Y'all with me? Mm-hmm. Not, well, I became a Christian when I was 16. Is that the high point of your life? Does this make sense? Second thing, you can't coast on yesterday's victories. Well, I remember when. Those are all neat victories. But God's next assignment for you is forward. He doesn't give you a victory in the past so that you stay there for another 30 or 40 years. My dad's highlight as a pastor was when he was 42 years old. That was his biggest church. That was his most incredible time. And he lived till he was 83. And I constantly heard about this church. The highlight. And it was so powerful and so neat that the rest of his life was just kind of not worth it. Y'all with me? The best days of your life, my life, of this church is ahead of us. Don't go back. And keep remembering all the good times and all. That's neat to do, yes, but walk forward. Step forward. Daily, Jesus reminds us to thank God for our daily bread. We're to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow him daily. The Bereans were blessed because they searched the scriptures daily. Paul noted that in Christ, we die daily. Listen to this. You guys ready? Last thing. This is awesome. Awesome. Remember this. God doesn't provide strength for tomorrow or for the next hour. He provides strength for the moment. The next step, he provides strength for. Not tomorrow, we don't know what tomorrow brings. Not for next hour, we don't know what the next hour brings. But he provides the stuff for now. Again, I appreciate the prayers for safe travel and all that. We've gotten in the habit of praying that, not for safe travel or safe things or whatever, because, boy, Jesus threw his disciples into some pretty unsafe places. But Lord, give us what we need to handle whatever you've got for the day. And if it's an accident, my boss had a bad bike wreck Friday. He was going to be in the Ironman. You guys know what an Ironman thing is? You ride the bike and you swim and you run and all that stuff. 112-mile bike, 26-mile run marathon, and a 2-mile swim. He had a bike crash Friday. Broke 3 ribs. Punctured lung, you know, all this stuff. And so his wife put on Facebook, we had to cancel 7 airline tickets this next week. Steve was ready to go. He has been training for years, especially hard the last, you know, year or so. And it's gone. God doesn't provide strength for tomorrow, he provides strength for right now. And it's always, do you trust me right now? If we start looking at things down the road, then we start looking, just like Abraham did with Sarah, I got a good idea how we can do this air thing with my servant Hagar. It just doesn't work out. Any thoughts or questions or ideas on that message today? That's the best message I've preached to you guys in 2 weeks. It's true. Oh, I love you guys so much. It's just fun being here. You know that? Let's pray. Father, thanks so much for your message. Give us opportunities this week that will remind us of how we can trust you. Trust you for the moment. And trust you whatever you have for us in the next step of where you want to take us and what we're doing. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. If the men will come forward for the communion, for the Lord's Supper. Go ahead. On the night that Christ was crucified, he brought the disciples together and broke bread as they ate. Father, we do thank you for the bread which symbolizes your sacrifice on the cross for us. Father, we ask that you would intervene in our hearts, present those things that we need to confess to you, make our hearts clear, make our hearts toward you. We trust you, we love you, in Jesus' name. That we should examine ourselves as we take the Lord's Supper, confess any sins, and so forth. He also said that as often as you partake, you declare the Lord's coming till he comes again. And Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. After the meal, Jesus took the cup. And gave it to the disciples. It says, this represents the blood that I'm about to share for you. Father, we do thank you so much for your sacrifice on the cross, paying for our sins and providing us a way to the Father. Thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice. In Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus said that the juice is represents my blood. When you partake of this, do this in remembrance of me. Again, Father, we thank you so much for your sacrifice. Thank you for giving the bread, your body, the juice, your blood, that covers our sins, that make a way to our Father. Thank you for loving us when we were so unlovable. Thank you, Lord. We love you. We know that you love us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. I think it is Fred's show. Let me get you some water, Fred. For you that don't know, he gave me some water with a goldfish in it.
6 months ago.
It's been a while.
Somebody gave it to you. Everybody is welcome to stay. Only members will be able to vote on this. If I counted right, I think we have a quorum this morning. We didn't have last Sunday. And what I have is a sheet that has the names of the members and stuff on. If you would just initial to the left of your name, so we have a record. And I'll start it up here, and if you want to just work it backwards. Double check. 14 we have. Okay, and we needed 13 for a quorum, so we are fine. The names that have been presented so far are Lana and Larry, Kim Klein,
Joyce,
and Kathleen Petrie. So those are the names that have been nominated. We only need five. According to our bylaws, we need five on our search committee. And if there's any other nominations or... Larry. I would rather be an ex-official member. Help with the search team in any way possible that I can. We do have a good slate of people. I would be more than happy to be a resource person. And I have gotten some stuff from Pastor Jim that's called a toolkit, which kind of gives you the walking outline of what you need to do. Pastor Jim has also ordered a couple of books for the search committee, which will also give some guidance and that. I would rather be just a resource person than being on the team and willing to help out in whatever I can. Because we do have five that have said yes, they would be on the team. So if I have a Lana?
I'm gonna go along with Larry. I think you should be on the team. I would rather be a resource person too, so I think that it's we would more appreciate you as a good team leader in there. So I'm with Larry on that one.
Other comments?
I'll second that.
I'll keep you clear. That would put a six on the team, which is all right, I guess. So, okay. Do we... Then we have a slate of six. Do I have a nomination that we vote for the full six, or do you want to vote for each one individual? Each one individual.
Vote for six, and then if somebody isn't there, you have enough to make decisions.
Okay. All right. So we'll do it by... voice vote. All in favor say yay.
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 All opposed say nay. And we have it. I would just ask that as a church, please keep this team in prayer. This team needs your help. If you have suggestions, questions, come to us and ask. If you see something that you don't like or you do like, please share it with us as a team so we know where you're standing. Because we need your input. Very much so. And we want to follow God. We don't want to run ahead of Him. I do believe that God will lead us in the right direction. And so I would truly ask for your prayers as we get to the meeting. I'll shake your hand. Any other comments? Is not something that I take lightly. With that, do we have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Okay, second? Okay, all right. We are free to go.